could only be right. Do you like
very
the pick,
very fitting, you know? Fits the theme. I'm not as sold on it as maybe some of the panelists. It can work if they can buy time and space for it to come online. They want to go very split push heavy. You've got three cores that all can split push in the Beastmaster, Ember, and Morphling. They've got the Relocate as well, so even a support that enables split pushing. They want to avoid this five-man team fight at all costs. And I think this was VG Gaming's reaction. They're like, man, I thought we normally had the better team fight. What happened last game? We didn't win on team fight. Let's correct that. This game around, they get Warlock, they get Sand King, they get Magnus, they get everything they can to throw in that team fight to make sure Liquid doesn't beat them there. And Liquid, it feels like Liquid knew they were not going to be able to team fight and gone very heavy on the split push. So they found a response. I like seeing Freeze on the Legion. He's, I think, his second time playing at this tournament. He's going to be going mid against the Ember, which is good matchup for him. Also, a hero that can deal pretty well if it's a dual lane mid, so he's not going to be too afraid of Io helping out the Ember because he can always press the attack off the Searing Chain. So very nice hero to run mid against this potential dual lane.
Yeah, and you can see that this is also going to be a situation where you don't necessarily have to bring those other heroes in to help out the Legion Commander too much. This means that Magnus, of course, heading down their bottom with the Sand King. Now, do you think that bottom lane is potential to maybe get aggressive and punish this Morphling pick, who can sometimes be thought of as traditionally a weak laner, particularly with the Lion?
They've got two range versus two melee, but that doesn't necessarily mean the range heroes are going to come out on top. Morphling doesn't offer a whole lot. He's also not a very long-range hero, so Lion also, if you use the tree lines and get a Burrow Strike on him, can be punished and bullied a bit as well. So it does look like the dual lane from Liquid is going to play defensively, use their pulls, and not look to fight into the Sand King Magnus from the start, at least.
Oh, and we're looking at it for a little while there in the mid lane. So far, Ember Spirit and Legion Commander very evenly matched. We're not seeing a whole lot else that's going on bottom as of yet. Maybe as the levels start building up, the things will change around a little bit in this one.
This is the Shockwave last hit to steal from Kuro. Kuro got it from the trees, but they are going to try pressure Matu underneath his tower here. He knows there's a creep wave on and wants to get on top, but I think Vici Gaming missed an opportunity to go for the side pull on the big camp here. They're going to go for it now, but Kuro's going to immediately stop that one. So he could have gone for it. Oh, no, okay. Gets the Centaur pull over still, so they'll salvage that pull slightly.
Kuro pulls it back
gets
again.
It back, yep. All right, so this pull game at bottom is going to be the key thing between the two teams, and I think missing that first big camp pull, instead they went for the stack, is a bit detrimental to this Vici Gaming lane. Now there's three heroes down here, they will be contested a bit more.
Yeah, and this does mean that Miracle is going to be left alone in that mid lane. Not necessarily the greatest of matchups for him, as you mentioned a couple of different times, the press the attack, being able to take off those chains. The one lane that we haven't talked a whole heck of a lot about is up there in the top with the Beastmasters. Anything we need to be really worried about up here?
Not really. Not until there's level 6s coming into play. It's a Warlock, so there's no stun or slow from this hero. Mid lane's a bit
freeze.
More interesting.
Freeze. Taking a lot of damage.
Yeah, he's almost dead. Miracle doesn't have a Searing Chains for some time, but right-click damage, not going to get the job done. He's going to get back to his shrine at least, so still has that available as GH will fill up his bottle with the Arcane Rune.
Well, the sort of, you know, tug of war, if you will, of GH moving between the bottom lane and the mid lane is kind of catching BGJ a little bit off guard, it feels like. And we've seen what this Miracle Ember Spirit can do when he just kind of dominated the early stages of one of the previous games as, well, wave from forward. Matumba Man getting a little bit aggressive with FY there.
Yeah, I think he knows that once that burrow in with Caustic is being used, there's no Sandstorm if you wave on the Sand King. He doesn't really want to fight a very heavy Agimorphed Morphling. And the good thing about this build is that he's getting extra value from these Tengus. He's healing up. And also the Magic Wand. He gets a lot of heal out of these two items. And Matu's being able to play pretty aggressive. He has chewed through 7 Tengus. He started with 8 in this lane. But because of the constant harass, he really needed it.
Yeah, it looked like he also even dropped a couple of those trees down to get the bonus regen out of it whenever possible. So very heavy harassment going on, but he's been able to get his farm. Clearly not as well as the Juggernaut has, considering the Warlock is there. Just a really hard support to zone out that Beastmaster.
Yep. Yeah, top lane being pretty handily won, while mid lane is slightly Legion favored. Miracle had already used his Shrine when he almost got the kill on Freeze, so it kind of evened things up with both players having to use their Shrine. And kind of see now that Legion has a slight edge in terms of CS and even an HP advantage. So Miracle's going to be banking on trying to find a 4-minute rune here.
Well, you can see also Observer Wards planted there to the side in the bottom lane just to make sure that they get eyes on any potential pulls that come in. It feels like, at least for now, VGJ not really wanting to try and get too aggressive, but is it something where they need to be worried at all about the Morphling getting free farm? Like, how does this hero fit within our current meta?
It's not a worry if you get a lot done when you get your ulties. I mean, the big thing you look at with VG Gaming's draft is just how strong they are in teamfight and with ulti. So if they can take objectives, get an advantage, and play around those spells well while not getting split pushed, then it's not a problem. But if they don't manage to take too many objectives and use smokes and teamfight well around those ulties while Morphling farms, that's when you do worry, because the longer this game goes, the more it's going to swing back the way of the Morphling.
Oh, Miracle getting aggro here with GH in the area, but as soon as that press the attack comes out, they back out.
Has the raindrops here. He probably knows what they did against him when he was playing the Ember, and after last game, we'll be playing with those defensive items.
What's up, a man going to waveform back, not wanting to get caught out there. We've seen just how powerful that ROTK mag is going to be eventually.
I mean, they're constantly harassing Martu, but he's still farming, and he's not even being zoned out of this lane. The Tengos and now the Ring of Health and the Magic Wand charges seem enough to sustain him in this lane. And this is with a very heavy Agi Morph. So definitely a well-played lane from Martu so far, but it's also a farming Magnus. ROTK has Arcane Boots already. He's got a ton of CS and levels as an offlane Magnus, and Beastmaster, you're looking at, what, 10 CS, 12 CS? He got most of that in the jungle, I believe, as well. So nowhere near the farm on the Beastmaster as there is on this Magnus. So lane's being won, at least marginally, by VG Gaming.
Well, now the initiation comes in. ROTK, oh, he's going to be able to get out of that one. Actually going to be able to skewer away as the Hex came out, and they're not going to find a kill with that rotation. Wasn't a ton used in that engagement, really, but would have loved to pick something up there.
They don't have their shrine. And Kuro has an Impale waveform. They've got the first blood.
Nicely played, and now FY is going to get the Sandstorm, so that keeps him alive. Could can try to trace a little bit from a Tumba Man.
Doesn't want to chase for that waveform coming up, so does go for just like a cheeky little value caustic, but we'll have to back all the way off and probably even head back to base to heal up.
So level 6 is now online for Freeze. I imagine we're almost going to be there as well for the Juggernaut. Do you think that there's value in trying to make those rotations? Or are these heroes just a little bit too hard to lock down for Team Liquid?
Rotations for the Juggernaut or for doing Liquid?
The Juggernaut rotating into either mid or the safe lane of the Liquid.
I think you can if there's a dive. Like what happened just then at bottom lane, you can TP in. But I don't think you want to TP in and then expect your Sand King to be able to get a Burrow Strike off. So if a dive happens, he's got the TP. He's bought the TP, but I think he's going to be using this more as a reactionary TP than like a setup TP. So he'll wait for perhaps a call from a teammate like, okay, come and TP in. They're diving me. Let's counterplay this. So for now, he wants to just stay top, continue farming, aggressive. As much as he's known for like the CDC days where he would TP in as soon as he hits 6 to the offlane, that isn't quite his playstyle so much these days.
Yeah, I guess one hero that could potentially make that happen, though, is the Beastmaster, who does almost have his 6 and Roar online. But aggressive, going to keep the pressure on to this Tier 1 tower in the top lane. Could potentially even think about dropping a healing ward soon and just keep the siege a-going.
Tower claims in the safe lane going to become a big part of what the two teams can do now. And that's where, Beastmaster goes for a rotation. It's great to perhaps find something early with the Roar. He does leave that tower exposed, so perhaps more so he may be calling for like a Ember plus IO rotation up top, depending on what runes you find. This is where getting a high-impact rune can make a big difference. You find a Haste, you find an Invis. Those are the kind of difference-making runes at this stage of the game that can set up some kills.
ROTK there.
Oh, they smoked. Freeze up top.
Trying to find him. Chains are going to be there in just a second if they can get into range. But
that was heads up from him. He didn't even go for the rune. Kuro was smoked and everything, and he felt the aggression coming his way. That was some really good map awareness from Freeze.
All right, well, the player, a couple people had some questions about in his ability early on, is certainly showing up in this one, at least in this game, as Matumba Man takes another couple right clicks in from FY, going to continue his farming. And you can see that, you know, between him and the Miracle Ember, they've been able to top the net worth pretty much at this point, having themselves a good old game.
Well, a little farming truce, I guess, for now between those two, but yeah, Legion Commander not quite keeping up with the Ember. Ember had, I think, a triple stack that he farmed with the IO because he was losing this mid lane. That's the key thing to know here. Freeze is probably like, how's this Ember get all this farm? But a triple stack from the IO that Io helped him farm has made the difference there. Matu needs to be careful.
In some trouble. They got the RP as well. The counterplay comes out, though. Lion making it work. Is Matumbo Man going to be able to walk out? Oh, a great Hex is going to be able to keep him alive for the moment. Also, body blocking now. They're trying to find this kill desperately on a miracle. They drop down the Omni Slash as well, but it's not quite there. The Epicenter, they're continuing the chase. He doesn't have the mana, though. Matumbo Man in trouble and is going to fall. Aggressive with a double. And now Lion as well. Duel to boot. Triple kill. Kill for aggressive at just under 10 minutes in.
It was such a good move because they saw all the Liquid Heroes mid. That top rune smoke from Kuro left Matu's Morphling exposed. So they go in the Morphling knowing they can like burn it. Even if he goes, he replicated, he went full strength. So they couldn't initially kill him, but they also know he can't replicate out. He can't wave them away. So they're going to get the kill eventually, assuming Liquid don't respond. They do respond, but they kill the heroes coming in. That Omni Slash works out better because not using it on the Morphling, man, he still had it for the Ember. They get that bigger kill, and then they eventually clean up the Morphling as well. That was the dream outcome for VG Gaming. They shrine up as four. They're ready to go and fight again. They don't have ultimates, though, and that's definitely something you have to be a bit wary of. They want to fight around ultis. Warlock does have level six, but the rest of the team not quite ready to go with theirs.
And of course, this also shuts down the farming potential of that Morphling down there. Tower not going to be up, and well, Matumbo Man is constantly going to be under fire from now on throughout this game.
He's going to be perhaps looking at that offlane rotation soon where he's going to lose control of his jungle and have to go to that offlane to farm. Mid lane Jewel.
Oh, they just drop it right there on top of Miracle. And guess what? They're going to be able to skewer back in. Ooh. Barely able to escape. And Kuro with a little bit of a heads-up play there as well, throwing out the Earth Spike.
That's why his Barrow Strike just a little bit far away. Perhaps could have used it sooner. That was level 4 Barrow Strike, but luckily, Miracle escapes. I don't know if he realized there was a Remnant up because it seemed like he was hesitant to try and Barrow Strike it. But either way, not too much missed out on there. They have their ultimates coming back up, so it feels like, yeah, they want to force the issue at this mid lane. Jugging the front lanes with Blade Fury is a pretty hard hero to go in, and they've always got the press the attack to bail out anyone who gets initiated on.
Well, and yeah, you see here in the middle lane, Miracle able to dissuade them from going any further, and does look like VGJ, they're content with that early start, particularly killing off the Morphling and taking the tower. They're just going to go back to farming for a bit.
I mean, they can play the farm game even against the Morphling because they've got an Empowered Jug. He was farming a double stack of Ancients. He's able to farm very efficiently early on. You get so much more money from killing Ancients than you do neutrals that if you have heroes that can kill Ancients early on, like Legion and Jug, that means you're going to heavily outfarm your opponents. Morphling can't really kill them all too easily on his own. So, something where VG Gaming will have an economic edge for the time being.
So, smoke now in the mid lane. It looks like Lion is heading off somewhere. I'm not exactly sure if that was.
Oh, has his level 6. It looks like a warding mission. More so than anything else. Wants to get perhaps vision of the Ancients. Walks into aggressive. They see the, I think they see the ward. Fast Blade Fury and when that smoke pops and you see just a Lion, you're thinking like, is he really smoking to kill us or is he just putting down a ward? And you're a bit surprised if that doesn't get dewarded fairly quickly. Yeah, that it's taken out right away. Yeah,
immediately. They knew it was up and, well, maybe he could have even killed the Lion there, but you got to play it safe. Make sure that you don't end up getting killed.
I mean, a smoke pops, you don't know if that's three heroes. You're about to get Hex roared. He had to go for the Insta Blade Fury to stop a Hex or an Impale, so just safe, calculated play.
Well, good bit of DOT there coming in from Miracle again. And they've got all of this magical damage. You know, you think about an Adaptive Strike as well as sort of a waveform forward through it with the Lion Finger, all that other stuff. But it's not really been a pace of the game where they've been allowed to find those pickoffs that they might want with this lineup. But there it is going to be. The Relocate coming in, trying to take him down. Remnant forward in trouble. The Rock counterplay. It's not going to be enough, though, as it looks like. Omni Slash dropped. Miracle barely left alive. One more punch, and Fenrir takes him down with the Golem.
Yeah, ultimately acceptable trade for VG Gaming. They do use two ultimates, and you I think last game we talked a bit about, like, oh, ulti's on cooldown, go and get stuff done on the map, but they've got a lot of big ultimates. They've still got Epicenter. They've still got RP, and that's a Blink RP and a soon-to-be Blink Epicenter. FY just a couple hundred gold short of his Blink Dagger, and with the Rock still there, they can actually push this Tier 1 tower. So early aggression from VG Gaming paying off for the most part. Legion Commander not the biggest hero to lose as well, but it does look like Liquid want to try and defend this top lane. They still have that Finger of Death, and that's definitely a cooldown I see them wanting to use early on to find some of these key pickoffs.
Still the battle of this five-man versus the split push. Morphling is getting farm in the bottom while all this is happening, but it does look like they're going to be able to press the issue a little bit as now Kuroki gets initiated on. There's the RP, the Epicenter. They're all gone. No way out for Liquid.
Yeah. Taking advantage of the Morphling pick is really what this is. They know this is a hero that does not want to fight. The only reason Matu would TP in is if there's a tower dive on equal terms. Like, he'll TP in if a Roar or a good Impale came out. He's not TPing into a lost fight. He's only TPing into, like, a somewhat neutral or Liquid favored fight to clean up. Fight like that, he just wants to keep on farming. And Vici Gaming, no. We have no Rock, we have no Omni Slash. Doesn't matter. They have no Morphling. Morphling is not going to try and fight. If we get the jump, we win the fight. They take the tower. Miracle, similarly, looks like he just wasn't able to TP in. His TP was on cooldown. He was at the mid lane. And as a result, Vici Gaming find themselves ahead here in the early game. All three cores doing well. The support Sanking had a 14-minute blink dagger. This is a dream start for the Chinese squad.
And potentially now thinking about going for that next round of towers as well. I mean, they do have a couple ultimates coming off of cooldown pretty soon with the Omni Slash almost there. It's feeling right now like VGJ, the only thing slowing them down is, you know, the slow decision-making that they've been making in terms of going from turn to turn. But there's going to be a catch, Burrow Strike. Just messing a little bit with Miracle.
Maybe bait out an Invis Rune or something, but doesn't look to be the case here.
Dual damage isn't very high on Legion Commander, but in this game it feels like it's a little bit more about the lockdown than anything else as the smoke comes.
You're not too worried about Legion snowballing and getting lots of dual damage. There's more than enough damage going around with the Fatal Bonds Warlock combo, the Epicenter, the Omni Slash. Dual damage is just like icing on the cake if you get it. Mind Control, nice bit of play at top, is getting a T1 tower for free, but he thinks they're not here because they didn't defend the tower, but turns out, they're here.
Well, Cherry on top coming in just a second as they take him down with the duel there. And Kuro tried to get the counterplay out there with
Kuro. Here comes a Blink Baru soon.
Earth Spike trying to TP. It's a nice play, but no way out of that one. The right clicks come through, and Kuroki is going to die. Double kill for Freeze. They're set up to go in on the top, but guess what? They're
space for bottom, though. They want to try and get this tier one. Aggressive's ready with an Omni Slash, though.
Well, they're on top of Matumpa Man, immediately going to replicate back.
They've got to run fast. Sanking has TP'd in, which means Blink Baru strikes are there looking. GH, Miracle will both TP out. Good call from Liquid to get out of that bottom lane. They felt like the space from top lane almost could have been enough to get them T1 tower, but with the Omni Slash, the Jug already in position, they had to run away from that. It will be a farming game from Liquid. They fall back, they're going to farm up some Ancients. Machu's got a double sack there, but also doesn't feel all too confident to farm it, knowing that his jungle is being somewhat invaded by Vici Gaming.
And sort of reminiscent of what happened in the last time, this is a Midas Warlock now who's winning, but...
Are they going Roche with this? Necrobook is... Yeah, I think they're sneaking Roche.
This would be huge if they're able to get it. I mean, 2-10, they need something to go back into their favor.
That's a really nice call. They're going to show heroes elsewhere on the map as well. They see Ember. You look at this lab and you think, can they Roche? You'd say no. But Necrobook, Agimorph, they can. If Vici Gaming read this Roche going on, I would be shocked.
Well, great play, and it does look like, at least for now, down below half HP, they're going to be trading out sort of the Tier 2 tower in the bottom lane for it. But, I mean, if Liquid do take this Roche, can they come back and defend this and take a fight?
No, this will be, in my mind, at least a farming Aegis. Even with an Aegis, this doesn't change the situation for Morphling. Like, he still does not fight into the five men of Vici Gaming. I think more than anything, the biggest thing this accomplishes is it stops Vici Gaming getting Aegis. Because Vici Gaming with an Aegis can look to break high ground. So you've now forced Vici Gaming to spend the next 5-10 minutes taking out of towers and not really wanting to push high ground. Ember and mid will get away. So in my mind, at least, they're not fighting with this. They're farming. They're split pushing. Perhaps Matu can use it to split push. Maybe he gets caught, but then still has a replicate escape when he respawns off of the Aegis. And as said, it's the block. It's preventing your opponents getting it, because an Aegis on aggressive Juggernaut could be game-winning.
And now Morphling does have that Lincoln Sphere completed, so even if FY finds him here, it's not going to be a kill in any stretch of the imagination. He's going to be able to head back there to the sides. I mean, considering that VGJ do end up losing out on that, they can still, as you said, move around the map and take down the Tier 2 towers, potentially.
Tier 2 towers, playing the vision game, get wards up. I really like the ward they have in their own jungle. Normally you wouldn't see a defensive ward right by where they're standing now. But that's the kind of ward that's going to catch out the Morphling. When he's split pushing, he'll split push the top lane, then fall back and farm those two jungle camps. So this spots that dire jungle camp, which is mostly farmed by Radiant carries. That top left jungle camp is a commonly farmed spot for Radiant carries. So keeping vision of that, vision around the secret shop, they're looking just to find pickoffs through the warding game right now. and punish whatever they can, because Liquid will not be looking to teamfight them. And if they're split pushing, you at some point you need to kill heroes. You can't just win the game purely by killing buildings unless you're breaking high ground, which without an Aegis might be a bit tricky for them. So Aggressive goes into the Blink on his Juggernaut. All of these catch and pick off items are coming up for Vici Gaming.
And I mean, you think ever since that disastrous fight towards the top, it's basically been VGJ moving around the map and doing whatever they want unhampered. Yeah. But now you do finally have some counterplay coming out as Liquid were able to move in, take down that bottom tier one tower. They're pressuring the tier two as well, at least for a moment. Now it looks like they're going to back out again. Matumba Man replicating away.
I mean, Freeze has the hunting item. He's gone straight into the Shadow Blade.
Fenrir is going to get relocated upon. They find one kill, and that's a decent one.
Yeah, I mean, if Liquid are getting the pickoffs and they're the ones split pushing without getting caught, that is very much their advantage. Freeze found no one at the bottom lane with his Shadow Blade. I like the Shadow Blade more than the Blink because it's better at dealing with split push because you can Shadow Blade through a creep wave, whereas if you get the Blink and you want to go, let's say you want to go into this Radiant Jungle, you've got to walk through the lane where you maybe reveal yourself, but having a Shadow Blade just gives you... like, it's kind of like a pseudo smoke in some ways. You can go through lanes, pass where there's normally vision, and find pickoffs. So it, in my mind, it's the perfect item for this game, but it's how he uses it, where he decides to TP and look for those kills that's going to decide whether or not he finds pickoffs with it.
Oh, and so far, Liquid have been doing a pretty decent job of avoiding all of these ganks. GH here might end up running his spirits into a couple of these heroes, but well, there is going to be the Burrow Strike connection, and GH going to give away a bit more damage here as it looks like mid lane able to find some more, maybe going to tell off a Tumba Man who's going to get skewered, pulled back in, still switching over to Strength 4, but is going to walk out.
He's still got a Replicate. Well, it's Replicates at mid, but yeah, he's still got Aegis. That's like that's kind of what you get the Aegis for there. They can't commit to... they could have thrown like another ulti or two, but what's it going to do? You're wasting ultis on an Aegis, and then he's going to escape afterwards, and Mind Control split pushing the bottom lane. This is perfectly played from Liquid from a position up behind. Like, don't get me wrong, they're still at a disadvantage. It's still entirely Vici Gaming who are like kind of controlling the tempo, but Liquid... oh!
Yeah, that'll happen. And Kuroki now, one quick hit. There was a duel up in six, but don't want to tempt it.
Yeah, so while Vici Gaming are the tempo setters, it's Liquid who are like the disruptive force in this game. The split push will keep forcing people back. Mind Control almost took down that tier 2 top tower, just didn't quite have the damage to go for it. He is using the Hawk. Vision is so key this game. When you're split pushing, if you have vision of your opponents, it makes such a big difference, and he's using those Hawks over this top tree line to constantly scout things out, and he has finished his Necro 3. It's just back at base waiting for him once he's done split pushing up here.
So in your eyes, what is that item that allows Liquid to be able to start to take the fights? Is it just the E-Blade on the Morphling?
There's no one item where it's like, all right, let's go team fight. At no point in this game will Liquid ever say, let's go 5v5, guys. It's going to work out great. If Dire have ultimates, they will always be split pushing.
All right.
At 600 Morph, even 600 Morphling, I want to say, they will choose to split push because that's just how good this Dire team fight is. But...
this is going to be a replicate down, but just a replicate for the moment.
But, the Ethereal Blade will make a difference in that Matu is no longer just a split pusher. He's also a pickoff hero. Like, he can find ganks. He can find pickoffs around the map, which makes a nice little boost in what he's no longer just creating space by split pushing. He's killing heroes. He's slowing down the push. If he can burst a Warlock, like, let's say Vici Gaming are like, all right, we've got an Aegis. Let's go five-man push. Matu's job is then to get to the back lines, find the Warlock, shotgun him down with the Ethereal Blade combo. And while that doesn't necessarily lead to a team fight, because I still think even with a Warlock down, the Magnus RP, the Epicenter, the Omni Slash is too much to fight into, it stops the push because it's one less heal, it's one less team fight ultimate, it buys you time. So this will constantly be a game of split push and buying time for Team Liquid.
And you can see this continuing to happen. They do get the top tower denied by the Legion Commander, but it's another tower down.
It's so frustrating right now. This is Vici Gaming just getting pulled apart around this map.
Oh, Kuroki, it looks like they could be trying to set up there. Fenrir is also in the area. And it looks like they will be able to walk out.
Again, Mind Control. He's just made a home in these trees up top. Really good Radiant Vision around him from both the Hawk and the Observer Ward.
Oh, aggressive and also here.
The thing is, if Vici Gaming had that Aegis, they would have perhaps forced a high ground push. If they managed to somehow push the lanes out enough so that they can go high ground, and that's why Jug's gone this Lincoln's build. It's a very good game to go Lincoln's against the Roar Initiation, against the Hex Initiation from Lion. But you've got to be able to have an... you ideally want an Aegis to protect you if you're going for that high ground push, even so. So taking that Aegis was such an important play from Liquid. Like, that really if not for that, I think we would have seen VG Gaming attempt a high ground push. Instead, it's all tier 2 towers down, but nothing more. And VG Gaming's just sitting around. They're twiddling their thumbs right now. They're like,
nothing
what do we
do?
Let's go stop the split push. The second you head top, they're going to hide in the trees. Maybe you kill a support here. They're actually Liquid, have numbers. They want to go fight this? Nope.
This could be scary. You have the rest of VGJ that's moving up. This could be a huge pickup.
TP's out.
Oh, look at this, though. Liquid.
As I said.
They know what they need to do. All right, they got an IO.
It'll get a cheer, but it's not a win. This is not a win for VG Gaming. Do not be confused.
Oh, my God. He got the relocate. Is he going to get the TP?
It's on cooldown.
All right.
Well, he's going to buy out at least, but...
Space created. Freeze.
He gets dual damage.
That's going to be at least a little something-something going for him.
I mean, the crowd did not end up cheering for that one. I think they realized, like, wait a second. That was, like, a good 30 seconds to a minute of time where they were Morphlings free farming. Like, that was... that's not a good sequence of events for VG Gaming. Not really bad by any means, but it's not progressing the game for them. They need to progress the game to a point where they're going to take Rax. That's how you win this game. You're going to... It seems like Liquid are closer to taking Rax than VG Gaming are. Liquid's the one constantly pressuring Tier 2 towers. Next is going to be Tier 3 towers. VG Gaming are perhaps going to be all in on this next Aegis to break high ground. They're going to need perhaps some boots to travel early on to deal with the split push.
No, they do have heroes that can push out lanes very quickly, particularly Sand King getting more farm on him, being able to use that caustic as well to keep those lanes pressured.
The problem, Lyrical, is like when you're pushing out lanes with like one hero by themselves, they'll get picked off. That's where the IO comes in. You've got this relocate, you've also got a shotgun morphling. So Liquid not only have split push, but they have great pickoff. So any attempts to solo defend lanes will be quickly punished by Liquid. That was what they were attempting to do up top on Freeze.
Man, and just continuing to pull them around the map. Look at that. Miracle pulls in ROTKs, forced back to try and defend the Sand King, and then is able to get out and away again. So the Tier 2 tower taking damage, and you can see the sort of stagnant net worth lead that's slowly been building. It kind of feels like we're building towards this point where Liquid are going to take a pretty big win, though.
Rat is back. It's somebody call up Bulldog. He needs to know. It's his time to shine again, and competitive Dota may be here. That's the pickoff on the Warlock I talked about. It's such a free kill for a Morphling to get at this stage of the game. There's a casual cloak on the Warlock to try and give him some survivability against this. He's going to go into a Glimmer Cape. I think he realizes this shotgun is a very problematic thing for him. But this game is swinging Liquid's way. In terms of the graphs, it's a 7.5 8K gold lead for Vici. It's been a gold lead for them for the entire game, and it's even been slightly increasing, but tactically, it's been a very well-played and reactive game from Liquid. They've kept themselves in it. The big test comes with Aegis, so we haven't seen Vici Gaming with an Aegis. That's why this game feels odd, because normally a team gets this far ahead, they get that Aegis, and then they at least have an attempt at the high ground, and then you're like, all right, can they push high ground? Yes, no, that question's answered. We haven't had to even ask that question for 15 minutes despite Vici Gaming's lead because of that Roche sneak.
And, I mean, you look at the way also that it's played out for Liquid, and we haven't seen a finger of death. We've seen maybe two roars, not a whole lot of anything else from them. It's just been all hit creeps, hit buildings, and you do have the BKB that's there for the Legion Commander that was newly purchased, but you're also getting to the point pretty soon, I would imagine, with Matumba Man's going to deal enough right-click damage to just kill him off regardless. Like, the Manta style, I believe, is almost done, if I'm not mistaken, on the Morphling.
Halfway there, yeah.
Halfway there, and then once after that, it's usually just the Scotty, if I'm remembering correctly.
These Lincoln spheres are just so problematic because it takes away the catch. The jewel, you can't Shadow Blade in and jewel. You can't blink Burrow Strike. And both Ember and Morphling with Lincolns have instant escapes. The Replicate or the Fire Remnant out. The second that Lincolns gets gone and pop, you just instant escape. You have a one button push that's instant and you're out of there. So no real reliable way to initiate outside of the RP. And as a result, ROTK going for a Shadow Blade as well on Magnus. This, to me, is a must because that RP cast time means if you're blinking into RP, this is Miracle we're talking about. This is Matu. These are your 9K MMR players. These guys have some pretty good reaction times. They will dodge that blink RP.
Oh, God. This is so well set up. Freeze must have realized that he was getting hit by those creeps, though, so he is going to back out of there.
He's still vulnerable, though.
ROTK is also going to be there.
They saw ROTK with the sentry. They know it's a trap now. I think, smart from Liquid. The second they see ROTK.
Every time, they're just gone. And now look at this Miracle again in the mid lane. Just going to keep on hitting them.
Gosh.
It's whack-a-mole, Dota 2 style.
Tower deny. This crowd has gone completely quiet. That is astonishing. I mean, Vici Gaming up 8K gold, 13 kills to 4. This crowd knows a thing or two about Dota because they recognize that Vici Gaming are not getting much done at this point. That can very quickly change. All it takes is one misplay, one great catch from a Legion or a Magnus, and it'll quickly swing Vici Gaming's way. They want to go for that Roshan. This is a Roshan that Liquid may just say, they don't need to contest Roshan is the thing. If they can keep split pushing, now that the first Roshan they needed to contest by sneaking because they didn't have items, but now that they've got items to split push with, they're not afraid of Roche being claimed.
Yeah, and I mean, even if they are all in this area right now, Vici Gaming J, you have the Morphling down there in the bottom. They force out another fortification.
Another tower deny.
I mean, the towers are still going down.
You don't care about the money so much. I mean, it'd be nice. I feel like this gold graph would be a bit more even if not for the tower deny. It's like the third or fourth tower deny, but
I mean, GH has a mech. Like, he's pretty farmed on the IO. It's the lion that's definitely hurting a little bit.
Lion's Blink Dagger doesn't seem to be coming anytime soon. That's a pipe dream for Kuro, but this game is not going to be decided by a Lion Blink at this point. Perhaps later on it becomes more of a necessity when you want to pick off some of these heroes. But yeah, Roshan remains exposed. Two Radiant Wards suggest they might consider contesting it. I'm not really sure if that works all too well, though.
Yeah. Seems like it would end up being a little bit intense.
But they're just going to wrap. They see Roche going on. They use the Roche to go for the high ground. There's no glyph.
This is going down super quickly. And RTK, I mean, he's in position with the Shadow Blade.
They've left Roche open.
This is just an immaculate performance
from them.
The Liquid
get Roche?
They're pulling him back in. They're able to relocate and now could potentially even take the fight. The Omni Slash is there on top of Matumbo Man, but they're pulling him deep inside. Wow, what a great play. And now Miracle, he's just gone. They dropped the rock. It doesn't do anything. They've already killed off the Warlock.
They're going to lose Botrax at this rate.
They're getting pulled completely apart. Legion Commander is gone. Oh, Liquid just putting on an absolute killer performance. Matumbo Man takes the barracks. Where are VGJ? They're all over the map. They're nowhere at the same time. Burrow Strike off the mark.
Liquid are pulling all the strings.
Oh, my God.
To split Vici Gaming up, and they will take Roche for themselves while taking the Botrax. It's not just that they get one of the two. They get both. That is impressive.
Matumbo Man, oh, they dropped the RP onto one. Maybe it's something, but aggressive. Well, double kill for him, but they've got the Aegis on Matumbo Man, and that feels like it might be good enough. He is still fairly low in this. He's going to throw out an Adaptive Strike. They've lost Miracle, but he just waveforms out.
Oh, my Lord.
What an impressive display.
Defensive E-Blade blocks that. He's going to waveform out of here now. Matu's just like, see you later, guys.
Has a Manta style as well. The boot. GH is there for the defensive save if he needed to be. And that was one of the most outplaying maneuvers I've ever seen in Dota. That was absurd.
This is the kind of game that, you know, there are some Twitch emotes to describe what you want to do to yourself in these kind of games. It feels bad. It feels really bad to be in Vici Gaming shoes. You feel like you did everything right. You won the early game. You won all three lanes, more or less. And you can't push. You can't get Aegis. You just lost a range tracks. This is like rubbing salt in the wound at this point. GH is just going to hide in the trees, relocate Matu out. Just has to stay alive for 3 seconds.
Oh, freeze.
Yep, not going to happen.
Well, and you know, you're taking a look at it. It was still a 7,500 net worth lead. Now back to almost about zero. This is feeling like Liquid without even barely taking a fight. They have two more kills than they had previously, but it's just all those objectives.
And look at Mind Control top. He's sneaking in. He's going for the little sneaky deaky play. He wants to go in this top lane if possible.
Alan Radiant scanning just to make sure he's fine.
Oh, no, it's his scan. I thought that was a Dire scan looking for him that missed. But yeah, he's like, all right, I'm safe. Is he going to go for a relocate? No, they've got no relocate for 28. He's just going to hide in here and wait. If bottom lane ever pushes in the high ground, he can blink in. And this is just dirty stuff from Team Liquid.
And, I mean, it is going to be pushing that just natural pressure from the super creep. So it looks like he is going to head out again. We haven't seen too much split push in this meta, but Team Liquid showing that it's still very much possible.
It's kind of like this age-old, like, rock, paper, scissors with Dota. You know, there's this, like, there's three kind of, like, if you want to, like, very much simplify, like, how you play Dota and what strategies there are, there's, like, the five-man team fight. There's split push and there's gank. Those are like kind of the three kind of general areas of Dota. And split push beats five man. And five-man is better than gank. If it's, you're versing a ganking team, you want to go for, like, the five-man, so they can't gank you. But if you're versing a team that's trying to five-man, you want to split push, so you force them to spread apart. And that's exactly what Liquid have done.
Well, they're going to drop an RP right down there in the bottom lane. Miracle, on an instant. That is painful.
Hoping that the follow-up disables could get there in time, but not the case.
And Matumba Man almost has the Scotty.
This game just feels like there's nothing VG Gaming can do. I mean, they have this incredible 5v5 team fight, and you ask, like, what item did Liquid get to 5v5 fight? There isn't one. They're just going to keep on split pushing till the bitter end.
All right, duel there. The E-Blade's going to keep them alive for the moment, but they do finally find that kill, and Matumba Man now forced to relocate, or rather replicate
away. Oh, they go
for
the GH? Okay, that's... he's going alone. Cancels it.
Yeah, he's going to be out of there. Mind Control also trying to escape. ROTK is there. Can they break it? They are going to be able to break that TP. Ooh. Mind Control in some trouble. So already lost Miracle, now going to lose the Beastmaster. They do both have buyback, but it's something for VGJ, and you can see the crowd needed it.
No need to buyback Beastmaster with the minus 35-second respawn timer. They do steal a gem, which is perhaps one of the nicer things that could have happened out of that. IO couldn't quite get the tether off to relocate out the Beastmaster there at the end, but end of the day, it's still a very Liquid-controlled game. All it's going to take is one more split-push effort, and they'll get that top lane. Matu's going to have even more damage output with this Scotty. More stats to shotgun people down with, and, well, that is a concern. Vici Gaming have not had a team fight since the laning stage.
Well, this is something, too, where I'm thinking about just the macro sense of this series. This is the type of game that VGJ would want, where they're grouping up together, taking down towers, running down lanes, and it feels like Liquid have found an answer not just in heroes, but in play style. I mean, if this doesn't go well and VGJ are unable to close it out, it's kind of making you a little bit worried for the rest of the series.
Yeah, absolutely. I think VG Gaming have just been a bit slow to adapt. This game is still very winnable for them. I mean, you go back to like the difference in gold, it's already swung slightly back in their favor. The key thing is finding those pickoffs and pushing out lanes. I think they need to just forget about this whole mentality that their draft is purely about five-man team fight. They need to recognize that, wait a second, we need to be able to pick heroes off and push out lanes. That to me needs to come first. If you get enough kills and progress to the late game with some items, like you get a Refresher Magnus, you get Legion Commander some jewel damage, you get Sanking with a Hex, you get a six-slotted Juggernaut. He's got Butterfly, Lincoln's Manta. He's almost six-slotted already. Like, your lineup goes very well late game. Empower Jug. Like, this is scary stuff. Refresher Magnus. Like, you can... Morphling is not going to be able to carry this game in the late game. He's going to still have to split push, I feel. All of these Liquid heroes, at no point in this game do they want a 5v5. So, VG Gaming just need to be more disciplined, I think, with defending their lanes. They don't need to force these 5v5s. Like, they tried to force Roshan too much out of this feeling that their lineup has one purpose, which is to five-man down lanes, to force team fights, to force Roshan. But their lineup can do more than that. I think that's what they're starting to realize. Those kills up top, they've even just since then played more passively. They're just farming the lanes. They're farming their jungle. It feels like they've adapted. And with this ward, they actually see Matu. Not sure if that means they can kill him. And it doesn't look like they will be able to. They see GH instead. Perhaps a smaller kill, but a kill nonetheless.
Now trying to get him. There's the Burrow Strike. RP even used. Yeah. And that's pretty emblematic of what you were talking about, that this is a lineup where you don't need a five-man, just make sure you get the kill.
They just got to, I mean, they made, this is like the kind of thing where you're just going to say, guys, let's just play this game as if it's going to go 50, 60 minutes. They're never going to teamfight us. So you use an RP for an IO, that's worth it at this point, because teamfights aren't happening. It does mean you lose your main initiation, since your single target initiations are blocked by Lincoln Spheres. So Ember and Morph are free to split push like hell right now. With the RP on cooldown, the Sand King Burrow Strike, the Jewel unreliable at this point. Freeze doesn't have any good way to break a Lincoln's, but he does have a teammate with him, a potential Burrow Strike into Jewel.
Would be huge if they could get him, but
no,
looks like they're not going to end up going for
Freeze
it.
Freeze has to run now. They're hunting top, so.
If anything, it almost feels as if Liquid are the ones that are trying to make more stuff happen now themselves, if they are the ones that are maybe even under the gun a bit.
Yeah. Probably not feeling like too much pressure on themselves yet, but they also know like they're the team who has to be applying, like pushing out lanes aggressively. They can't just sit back and let VG Gaming scale. Oh, nice play.
That might be it. He is still going to be able to switch over to the strength form, taking so much damage. He is going to fall. They find the kill. That's some more dual damage for him, and maybe off of that they can make something happen.
using the jewel against the morph. Very, very effective way to lock him down and prevent that stat morph. Aggressive at bottom, does have Lincoln, so isn't too vulnerable right for Kuro. Looks like Kuro doesn't have any observer wards left. He's just trying to be in a sneaky spot here. Maybe thinking a relocate could come in.
Oh, again, mind control, Roar. They have the Necro books down as well, trying to take him down. They relocate. RP is used as well as the rock onto two of them. Miracle is still there as well. They're trying to survive and turn this fight back around. GH is dropping lower and lower, but they've got him taken down. Omni Slash is there.
It's
up popping out of it. Nicely played. Miracle.
Bit unlucky,
all anyway.
He'll take it. It bounced off the Beastmaster to the Ember, which meant mind control was free, and then he could just fire Remnant away.
Wow, now they've got another as well. Kuro here, but they get the duel off. That is going to be Kuro dropping down, and meanwhile, it's a little bit further. Miracle is forced back.
He still has a Remnant out. He is so good when he's playing aggressive there. He already Remnant out once, and he had another one to escape with. Ooh, aggressive. He blinks in. Can he find him with the bash? He needs a bash. Not going to get it. That was close. Great blink escape from Miracle. He got away from. He blinked away from the jug and insta-TP'd, knowing that he had no Remnant. Oh, he had a Remnant left still, but perhaps was a bit low on mana, and if Jug found him with a bash, that could have been a kill.
Wow. A very tumultuous couple of moments there, but still nothing really lost. And I guess the big thing is that this is still going to be Morphling, who is back up, didn't have to expend buyback or anything else like that. So you know, about a 10,000 net worth experience lead is roughly where we're sitting, almost 40 minutes into this game. And in your eyes, I mean, do you feel like either team has sort of taking a bit more of an advantage? I feel like it's hard to tell right now at this stage.
I feel like we're back to kind of this more even state, mostly because Vici Gaming, from the outside, feels like they've calmed down. Like, they've adapted, finally. For the longest time, it was like Liquid's in clear control. They were split-pushing. They split-pushed bottom racks while taking Roshan. It almost feels like it took losing a lane of racks for Vici Gaming to realize, like, wait a second, we're not under pressure. Our lineup can scale late game. Our lineup can just go for these kills and not. They don't have to worry about pushing lanes. By pushing lanes, I mean going for a lane of racks. Like, they need to worry about pushing lanes out, but they don't have to worry about five manning down mid with an Aegis to get a Rax. And I feel like that was their mindset with that second Rosh, and that's where they got punished. Now that they've lost the lane of racks, it feels like, all right, this is fine. We're not going to lose the game. We've got a Jug with Empower. We can push these lanes out fine. Magnus with the Refresher. Like, we're going to have so much late game potential here, and all they've got to worry about is the split push. But they are concerned about this Rosh.
Oh, they jump in immediately and take down Kuro. And now going to be able to find another. This would be a huge one if they can finish it off. Skewer pulling him back in. But Tumble Man, though, Ghost Scepter, going to keep him rather healthy.
Mid lane, meanwhile, the rat continues.
Oh, they're taking it down. But Tumble Man able to get the TP out. And as you said, mid lane is being pressured quite heavily. They take down the tower, force out the glyph. And Roshan still stands.
Morph didn't die. The big thing, I feel like Liquid's game plan there was to split push, and if they engaged at Rosh, they wanted to relocate Morphling in for the split push, but the key thing is they kill Io. Taking out relocate is incredibly important. Miracle's back in, though.
Oh my god, this guy just continuing to do
it. Taking a range rax, you know, bit by bit, he wants to just break Vici Gaming's spirit.
RP is down, too. This is filthy. And Skewer, yeah, no great answer for that one. Gonna chains him for a moment. They Burrow Strike, they're just gonna be able to break it, but I mean, at the same time, he doesn't really care. He's just going to be able to get out of there after he takes the range barracks.
Yep. Top lane already being pushed out by Mind Control as well. What a tricky game for Vici Gaming.
Does
feel again, it's tough. I said they'd settled down and changed their mindset a bit, and then it shows like, all right, we killed the Io. Let's go push down mid. And the second they try and group up and push, if they're ever grouped as, show themselves grouped as 4 or 5, that's when the split push gets them. But the problem is, by not moving out together as a five-man unit, they don't contest Roshan, and what's going to end up happening is Aegis and Cheese for Team Liquid. This is perhaps the point where Liquid can take a 5v5 engagement if they get, maybe not 5v5, they want to find a pickoff ideally to start it off, like get a Roar pickoff or an E-Blade pickoff, but they can very quickly turn a kill into a team fight or even just rush the buildings. There's no Glyph. Without Glyph, this melee racks at mid will die incredibly fast. Morphling has Aegis. He almost has money for a butterfly. Liquid sense victory here in game 3.
Smoked up, ready to look for the initiation. You do have Sand King down there on the low ground. Mind Control is there as well. They get the initiation to start it. There is going to be a rock drop on top of one, but Miracle is already there. Matumbo Man on top of him. They're trying to find this, and, well, it looks like the Sand King backs out again. They get the duel off. It is not quite going to be enough. They are already taking down Kuro, and it looks like Mind Control, after blowing out for the roar, is going to end up going back, but they take down the Mage Melee Barracks.
This IO relocate Rat Dota plays. They're going to keep on happening. Even the Manta Illusion's getting the tier 3 top.
Oh, my God.
Just whatever bit of damage they can do, and they still have an Aegis to play around with. Frustrating stuff. You take the fight that Liquid present you up top, and then IO's like, all right, there's a team fight. We might win it, but why risk it? Why not just take a Rex?
Mag already gone, just so rapidly evaporates, and they are going to try and come in now. Freeze as well as aggressive there. But they just back out again. A bash, maybe something coming here as Matumbo Man taking a good bit of damage. Another bash as well. He does still have his replicate away, though.
Yeah. And he still has an Aegis, too. So this is just trying to break an Aegis. Aggressive will have to back off. He went for the level 2 travels, which I kind of like because he's going to have to split push out of lane and may have want to TP onto a jewel. So having the TP onto a hero is definitely nice, but ultimately it's not going to win you a game here. And I think that's what we're finding. Freeze picks up a Halberd. This is a Lincoln's Breaking pickup for me. I don't really... I mean, Evasion's like, okay. Everything else about the item's kind of meh. It's really just single-handedly being picked up to break Lincoln's Sphere so that Freeze can go for Jewels.
And look at this again. Miracle moving along the top lane. Not really anybody here to try and stop it. Aggressive does move in, but this has just been the same frustrating thing for VG Gaming over and over and over again. Yeah.
Got to give credit to Liquid, though. They played their draft incredibly well. They've gone for the exact strat to try and beat this 5v5 teamfight lineup of VG Gaming's. The Roche sneak was really genius. Mind Control and Machu getting in there, and they've set themselves up to win this game. It's not quite there yet. Two lanes of Rax. With an Aegis, they could perhaps go for the third. They even ping out a DD rune. Oh, God. They can fight like backdoor protection with this. This might just be enough to go for that top lane.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage. That is a whole heck of a lot of damage that comes out.
Full Agi, that's pretty absurd. He can even tell his team, force a fight up top and I'll go for tier 4s.
All right. Well, this could potentially be the moment as... I mean, this is a moment where you kind of need another scale of... Burrow onto Miracle. They've got the duel as well. Kuroki gets a Ravage off there with the Earthshock. Now they turn it around. The first finger of death of the game. A double kill now from a Tumble Man. And they do have an Omni Slash there, doing a good bit of damage onto Mind Control. In some trouble, they manage to find that kill, but he's going to be hexed up over here. It's going to be Matumbo Man getting the right clicks off, that DD paying off as well. And they get the RP followed up with the Rock. Can they take them all down? Triple from a Tumble Man, a double. They end up all going down, but still, he's too large. This Morphling
still got an Aegis too.
Cannot be stopped. It looked pretty. It looked good. Was over on Agi for a moment.
Well, that's still a no Omni Slash. And with the IO's here to heal him back up, Matu's in.
Not stopping for anything. They do pop the glyph, but continuing to hit away at it. They just don't have any way to stop it. He's going to waveform forward, just evaporates Fenrir. They try and bring him down, but as you mentioned, Aegis is only going to be popped just now.
Miracle.
They're controlling Miracle. They pull him back in. Do they have an answer from a Tumble Man? He's taking a good bit of damage. As you mentioned, no 2 minutes without the Ember. He's actually Morphling. Woo!
Is he out, though? Freeze is still chasing. They see vision of him, but they also recognize they got to defend this last range Rax of theirs. Is it now or never? It feels like it is. 100 seconds, Ember died back, go for the win, or... I feel like you just got to let that last Range Rex die when you go for the win down mid, because I don't think there's any real late game at this point where VG Gaming can turn things around. They chewed through so many buybacks. They are pushing out this mid lane, but... Jug with Boots of Travel could come back in. This looks like an all-in kind of moment. No refresher on Magnus. He'll have just the one RP. Oh. Fenrir doesn't have ultimate either.
And look at that, oh my God, all right, they take him down. Kuroki's gone.
It's a lion, minus 25 respawn time, you know?
I mean, you picked up also a Deso now on the Beastmaster. It feels like they might know what play they need to make. Yeah, he's going in right now.
Okay.
And actually, Matumbo Man, they go for the relocate, going to go for out damaging the backdoor protection.
And he leaves the IO behind. GH will walk into the fountain and just, it's the safest place to be, you know? You're away from the enemy heroes. And instant escape. So now with Mega Creeps, VG Gaming all in.
All right, they're on top of him. They get the duel. He does still have buyback, though, and they're trying to heal him back up. GH saving him just barely.
Oh,
there is no
gosh.
Relocate. The Shrine Fountain to heal him back up a little bit more aggressive, going for the Blade Fury, just trying to bring this down to whatever possibility they have. But Matumbo Man turning onto aggressive now, trying to deal the damage they have to deal. The Burrow Strike again going to connect. There's
oh,
an RP, and a good Earth Spike there for the Seppin. Echi Center coming out as well. Matumbo Man pops the Mantis Style. They buy back on GH, trying to save him. They do finally bring down Morphling. He's
the
forced to buy back.
Though. Mind Control's going for the throne.
They want to take this down. Are we going to see them be able to take it?
Matu's
it
also
like
going
the
for the throne.
Over there, it is an exposed Ancient at this point. Over on the Dire side, go put Vision on it, and it is going to end up being the game. GG ends up getting called as Liquid
Ooh,
rat
boy.
Them to death.
Yeah, I mean, good, safe.